of, on the one hand, understanding what's going on, but there's a difference between what you're producing and what you're understanding, if that's going on, or if the other part is you can learn one way but not the other, and there's kind of a marked difference. So you might understand the textbooks and the lectures are like, I have no idea what's going on in this room. That's another experience. So you can go to the Accessibility website, look on learning disabilities, and fill out the questionnaire. And based on that questionnaire, we'll have a pretty good sense of what's going on. It was written by a psychologist. We provide interim accommodations based on that questionnaire to get you some assistance with it. Okay? So there's that. You may have this experience, right? So that, but to pay attention to it. I think the other thing I want to talk about is if you were in a job and you weren't sure how to approach a task, you'd ask for help, right? And you'd be expected to ask for help. If you didn't ask for help and your employer said, why did you ask for help, you really wouldn't have an answer to the question. Think about graduate school in the same way. You're in a competitive environment. Often when we're in a competitive environment, we think we need to know on our own, and we individualize the problem and blame ourselves when we don't know the answer, okay? So what I would encourage you to do is to switch that and say, hey, this is a level of information I've never worked with before. There's expectations here I may not fully understand. How could I? I just walked in the door. So I'm going to get assistance early to make this transition as strong and successful as it can be, okay? So I'd encourage you to reach out and ask for help, and that's what Student Life is for, and frankly, you're paying for it. So why not use what's there? The other service that's available, you've got the professional writing that you heard about from Peter earlier. The other place you can go is the Academic Success Center. Many of our learning strategists have done graduate work, so they're familiar with the tasks that you're struggling with. And they can meet with you one-to-one and help you think about kind of the mess of the week. So here's where I'm stuck. Can you help me figure it out, right? The other places, there are workshops running at Robarts Library, so nice and close. They're at the end of the day, and they can review sort of the learning strategies connected to academic work. Because if you've been away from the academic task for a while, you might go, what was it I was supposed to do, right? So to kind of wake that stuff back up quickly may be a really good use of time, okay? The other thing we talk a lot about is there is more meditation on this campus. You can meditate, I think, any hour of the day from Monday to Friday, okay? There are writing groups through the Academic Success Center geared to the graduate student experience. There's the Athletic Center and Heart House, and sometimes moving the body helps the stress levels and kind of releases the cognitive cobwebs, right? So that there's lots here, and the question is to get out and make that happen. Do you want to add anything around the kind of wellness room?
Yeah, for sure. I think you covered most of it. So in addition to all of those within student services, there's also the health and wellness department. So I'm one of many people that work there. Like I said, the majority of it is located down at the Poplar Center. There's actually two floors. So the first floor typically is more for the mental health services. So that's where you would see a counselor, a psychologist, or a psychiatrist. The second floor is the more medical and health end of things. So there's available to all of you are wonderful, really passionate doctors, nurses, specialists, dietitians, and a whole range of great medical professionals. So whether you're from Toronto or you're new to the city, it can be a great place for you to access pretty much any of your health and your mental health concerns. The way it works being embedded here is it's basically kind of a faster route for you to be able to access counseling. So I am happy to meet with each and every one of you, but if there's any reason why you don't feel that I'd be the right person or you don't really like the idea of seeing someone here in this building, building, maybe you want to have a reason to step out of the building and like walk a few blocks, that's totally great as well. You still have access to all the people there. It's just I'm one more person with me. So the majority of the people from my school, I believe, last year did come to see me when they were seeing a therapist, but by no means is that the only option. You also have access to a therapist at the Graduate Student Union, which is just kind of like down St. George a little bit and just across the street. And then there's also, again, available to you psychiatrists, psychologists, if you feel that you're needing kind of some more in-depth or intense work. In general, the way that embedded counseling works is that it's very short-term. So I most often work with students four, maybe five times in a given school year. So if you're in first year, I can see you for that length of time, and then in second year, I can see you again for that length of time, if that's what you need. Often, you know, depending on the issues and the reasons why you're wanting to seek counseling, within the first or second session, we can figure out if it makes sense to continue with me for that short time, or if you're needing some more intense work. I also do a lot of referrals. A lot of students like to get connected then after seeing me or kind of in the middle of seeing me with some of the groups that are available through Health and Wellness. So we have some really great kind of psychoeducational groups that help with anxiety, help with depression, help with bipolar disorder and a wide range of other kind of mood disorders that you might be experiencing. But really, like Candace explained, there's such a wide range of resources available, and I think the best piece of advice is to really just kind of like take advantage of the things that are offered to you, right? It's kind of one of the few times in your life, probably in academia and when you're at university, that you have like incredible professionals at your disposal for free, right? Because you've already paid for it. So it's great to kind of have to see people. If you are curious, if you're not sure if you kind of have a serious enough issue, I've already heard a bit of that today. I've heard that a lot last year when I was here as well. People were kind of hesitant because they wondered if this was like serious enough. Come and talk to me. It's not a waste of your time. It's not a waste of mine. And we can help to figure that out. I get to meet someone where they didn't have something that they could benefit from talking to someone, right? And I think that I'm a big believer that all of us can benefit from having that person who's kind of a bit removed from your life. I'm not a classmate. I'm not a family member. I'm not a friend. But I can be kind of that impartial person to kind of offer support or offer some feedback that can be really useful. And I think especially as you're embarking on this program right now, a lot of you are probably really motivated to like hit the ground running academic-wise, but you're still a human being and it's so important that you take care of yourself throughout this year, and I'm happy to be a support for that. Sometimes people are curious, especially with me being physically located here, how it works with confidentiality. That's why I'm Health and Wellness, but I'm just technically here for your convenience. So I'm not an iSchool staff member. I don't report to anyone there. They, at the end of December and then at the end of the school year, I do report general big picture numbers. So I'll say I saw 67 students, or I saw, you know, this many in the Master's of Information from that kind of demographic, but at no point do I ever report about you as an individual. So if your professor pops in and says, hey, did you see Sally? No way am I going to share that information. I can say, like, I don't basically know anybody here. So I'm kind of a weird person in that. The other piece is even with your classmates or if you have friends that are in the program and stuff, same thing. Like any therapist, it's always confidential, right? So you coming to see me is just basically shared within other health and wellness people. So if you went to see me and then you went to see a doctor, you could kind of down at the Health and Wellness Center, they would have access to the fact that you're seeing me. But that would be kind of the only way in which your information is shared. And if you ever have any questions about that, you can ask me as well. Or you can ask the Health and Wellness Department. Another thing I just want to share, so once again, really encourage if you're interested or you're thinking about coming to see me to just give a call to Health and Wellness directly, and you can just look at their website. I have their phone number here if anyone wants to write it down. 416-978-8030. And you can call them, again, kind of similar. We get really busy in October, really busy in November and December, but the sooner you kind of reach out, the easier it'll be for us to at least get to know each other a bit so that if we're still working together in October, we can kind of keep that relationship going. But one of the reasons why we have it set up where you call Health and Wellness is because they help in a few ways. So one is that the front desk will take your they have like a whole laundry list of questions they have for you in order to set up an appointment. So if you aren't already connected with Health and Wellness, they'll need to take down like your health card information. If you're an international student, your UHIP card. They can help with kind of arranging that as well if you haven't got that organized yet. They take like your, you know, next of kin, all that database info, they'll do over the phone with you, which saves you and I a ton of time. So I don't end up taking 30 of our 45 minutes together asking you all those questions, and then we have no time to actually talk, right? So by calling them first, you kind of get that all organized and established, and then when you come to meet me, we're just like ready to talk and get to know each other. The other thing is that sometimes I'm not actually the right person to meet, and they'll help you in figuring that out. So if you're asking for like help with changing your medication, I'm not a doctor, so you don't want to come talk to me about that. You're going to want to see a psychiatrist or family doctor there, right? So they can kind of help with rerouting you to the right person. Does anyone have any questions about my life?
Yeah. So can you just like walk into the Cochlear Center and get all that set up without being on the phone?
Yes, yes. So you have, thank you very much. You can call. The phone line can be very busy, so lots of times people find it actually easier to physically go down there, and you would just go to the first floor, health and wellness, like their first floor office, and you just ask to set up an appointment with the embedded counselor. It's helpful to always mention that you're in iSchool, but you can again still say like, I'd like to see the iSchool embedded counselor, or Jalen reminded me of my grade 2 teacher that I hated, and I can't look in her face without like feeling super uncomfortable, so I'd like to meet someone else. That's also okay. So you can do it in person, and that can be a bit easier. Any other? Yeah?
Two questions, if I may. The first one, if you already have an established relationship with a psychologist, would you advise still coming to meet someone like associated with the school as well, or do you feel like these services, you know, the services you provide are, you know, kind of more the first line, if you've already gotten to a point where you have an established relationship with a psychologist, is it, you know, you still get a lot out of the working relationship going through the wellness center. And the second one is just a curious question about like the practices in place for it, but just like insurance for counseling or for like psychology. Like we have a medical plan, yes.
Yes.
Good stuff.
Yeah. So good question. So if you're already working with a psychologist, a social worker, a therapist, or a counselor. It's definitely a personal choice if you would like to see me in addition or if you'd like to just continue to see them. It makes sense if you have this wonderful working relationship to carry on. One possible advantage I have is by working here last year and working here this year, I have a bit more of an insight into the program itself. So some of the common themes, some of the common stressors of being in the iSchool programs, I can kind of hopefully have a bit more understanding of than, say, somebody out in the community. Sometimes as well, maybe you're working long-term with somebody, say for depression or relationship issues, but maybe you have something more acute to come see me about. So maybe it's just more about finding your voice in a really crowded classroom and kind of coming over your social anxiety in that context, right? Or maybe it's not related to the school, but it's still just kind of like one other issue. You can kind of like, if you want, divide that up. So you see your therapist, your ongoing therapist for that big issue, come see me for something else, if that makes sense for you. The other question you had in terms of insurance, so you guys, if you haven't opted out of your benefit plan, you do have insurance coverage to see somebody, and that gives you a wide range of options. So I imagine it's the same as last year, but please look into it for yourselves. But essentially you have, last year, students in graduate program had, I believe, $500 per calendar year to be spent with therapists. A lot of therapists in Toronto offer a sliding scale. Sometimes I have people come and see me just to help with that referral. I can help you with that if you're looking for specific, you know, kind of like approach or therapy, if you're wanting to work with a woman or a man or someone from the trans community, if you have any kind of specific requirements, if you're wanting couples, family, all that. That can be something you can use with your insurance. I'm not part of that insurance, so I'm just paid through your student's fees, so you already kind of have access to me for free. Any other, did you want to ask anything?
I was thinking it'd be interesting to talk about the stressors in this program,
yeah.
Specifically and what you've seen.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Is that helpful for people here? So, again, just like, lots of it was a variety of things, so I mentioned through their personal life. So sometimes people feel like you have to come see me for like a school-related thing, like you as a grad student. You don't need to. So lots of people came to see me because they were coming back to school after a long period of time, or they haven't taken a break from school and it's kind of been go, go, go. If you're commuting, there can be stress involved. There can be stress with people in your life who aren't part of the academic world and don't really understand the pressures you're under. There can be stress with people who are part of the academic world and are also stressed out. Like the student panel this morning, there was a lot of people who kind of came for support around navigating group work and kind of the pressures they had with that, maybe setting boundaries with the people you're working with or helping with improve your communication skills. A lot of people talk about feeling like an imposter, right? So feeling, and you know, talking about how competitive it is to get into this program, how intelligent all of you are, and how accomplished you are to make it here can be very intimidating if you feel like you're the only one who actually isn't that great. So for anyone who isn't familiar with that concept of like imposter syndrome, it's essentially the notion that you feel like you're kind of a fraud. Everyone else is way smarter than you, way more accomplished, and you're alone in kind of not really having it together. So what was interesting last year was being able to work with lots and lots of people who shared that experience, because it helped me to then share with people, like, you know, I can tell you you're not the only one in the program, because I've seen 8 people this week also saying that they feel that way, right? So if that's ever coming up for you, I can definitely appreciate that, and I can also offer a lot of support in that. But really, there's such a wide range of backgrounds that you guys are coming from, wide range of life experiences, so there's going to be a really cool diversity in terms of reasons why you want to come to me. Yeah.
I think from the accessibility point of view, it's the additional time required that living with some kind of difference creates, right? So there's the academic demands, there's the life demands, and then you're navigating a condition that means life takes longer often. So I think it's that question of balancing. And how do you talk about that in a way that is bounded and professional, constructuous, kind of a kick-ass professional, and you've got something else going on that has been stigmatized by society, right? So there's that, how do you do that? It's a lot of the conversations that we have. We often talk about the impact on learning, not the condition itself. So I learn really well this way, it's helpful for me if, right? Rather than the kind of explaining a lot about what's going on. So that other questions?
Yeah, hi. If you had previous accessibility counseling at a other institution, is it possible to get your accommodations just flipped over to this institution, or do you have to start all over again?
It certainly speeds it up. Okay. So to bring anything you have around medical documentation or previous letter of accommodation is really helpful. And we will ask for the package to update you now, but bring it, certainly, it's a bit of a passport, so it's helpful. Yeah, hi.
Building on that, do you have like a certain like updatedness that a neuropsychological evaluation needs to be for proof of neurological difference, or if the last study was like 2000, or do I need to go through that?
So bring what you have, and it's enough to get you started. If you're looking for funding for, say, a light laptop or for adaptive software, we may want to update.
I already have all that stuff.
Then you're fine.
Yeah.
Yeah, it'll be enough. It's that once it's done as an adult, we don't change a lot as adults. Yeah.
Hi. Kind of going off of both of those, do you need any different paperwork or anything if you're an international student?
Well, so I would bring anything that you have, right? And then if we need to update something, we'll update it here. So it's just, we ask that psychoed assessments be translated into English. But that's about it. Yeah.
Hi.
definitely a more baseline question than others. So I'm resident of British Columbia and I moved here.
Yeah.
So I'm currently under the graduate student health insurance plan, right? So should I also get the Ontario health insurance plan, or should I just keep my British Columbia health insurance? Like that kind of stuff.
Do you know?
It's a good question. I think it depends on the province where you're from. So essentially, what I would suggest is call the health and wellness department because they work a lot with that. You can also call your graduate student union. I imagine both of them would be able to give kind of better information than I have, but I believe that each province kind of has a limit in terms of how long you can be out of the province and still use that plan.
Yeah, yeah.
So at that point, you would then, if you're planning on living here in Toronto for the next 2 or 3 years,
right.
It might, you know, I think it's probably within like 6 months or a year you need to switch over, and others here might actually have that info.
And then also you have to wait 3 months in the province of Ontario, so you kind of want to do that before,
like now.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
So like, should I just go to the health and wellness center and like, ask about more details?
Yeah, I think you can also probably look it up online just in terms of the provincial health card guidelines. Because health and wellness will accept any Canadian insurance plan, so you don't need, like, this first 3 month waiting period, you, with a BC health card, can still access all of the health and wellness services. It'll just be probably like when those deadlines, when you can change things over, that's when you need to kind of make sure it's up to date. But I recall seeing people last year, I think Quebec is a bit different than the other provinces, I've been told, but in general, like, there's kind of going to be a point in time when you can change it, and it might also be different if you're a student. So if you explain to people that you haven't actually like permanently moved to Ontario, but that you're a student here, it'd be important to kind of look up those details as well.
Okay.
But you probably want to start with both like the BC Health Care website and then the Ontario Health one.
Okay.
They'll probably lay it up for you.
There's also your question about province reminded me there is a bursary for students with disabilities for services and supports to assist your learning. And it can be up to $3,000 per year. First step is you apply to OSA, eligible for a dollar. Or if you're not eligible for a dollar, we add the disability-related services and supports, and often you are eligible. And if you're not eligible for that, we look for funding from other places. So if you're thinking that services and supports would help your learning, and you're registered with accessibility, there is funding available to you there. But the first step is to apply for OSA, which is often a drag, but it's one of those bureaucratic first steps.
I have a question about the embedded counseling at the high school.
Okay.
So if you've already seen a counselor at the Health and Wellness Center, and I do you have to see them to be transferred over to counseling at high school, or how does that work?
No, not necessarily. So if you're currently still seeing them, it might be a good idea to like talk to them about it and explain why you're wanting to switch over. But yeah, you can just, again, provided that I'm like the right fit for you, you can just give them a call and ask to see me. And one of the things I mentioned, kind of a lot of reasons why people might not want to come here, right? So there might be just like that comfort of leaving, but most students really did find it very helpful to see a counselor here. So it's literally like in between your classes, or maybe you have a class, you finish up, you have group work in 2 hours, but you can come and see me scheduled in there. It can be really helpful, especially come winter, to stay in the building. Yeah, so you can just call them and explain that you're now in the high school program and you'd like to see the embedded counselor. Yeah.
Anything else? So we've got like 3 minutes left. And before we go, can you just take out a piece of paper and a pen and write yourself a note about something you'd like to remember to do and one strategy that will help you do it, okay? So one for me is I have to walk over to their Heart House gym, but it's my choice whether I go in or not. But by the time I'm there, I go in. So it's that, what small thing can you do that might promote wellness for yourself and the community?